Good morning and welcome. Glad to have you at New Hope today. If you haven't been here yet this year, it's our pleasure to have you here in the month of January. Thanks for being here. If it's your first time ever here, there are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. Love for you to fill one out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We make a promise, and I believe we've pretty much kept our promise, and that is we'll not annoy you or aggravate you, but through the mail, we want to send you some information that tells you about New Hope Church and maybe answer a lot of your questions. And a little announcement to the ushers in the back, I am missing a clipboard. So it may have not made its way over from the bridge, so could somebody, is anybody awake back there? I need to find one more clipboard, okay? That would be great when we get to that announcement. Let me share with you a few things that's going on, and then we do have several prayer requests that we need to bring to your attention for prayer this morning. But this afternoon, all right after the last service, so at about 12:30, the Widow's Lunch Bunch going to be meeting at Sweet River. That's over in the Sierra Vista Mall here in Clovis, and they would love to have you come join them. We are going to be leaving on January the 30th for Ivory Coast, Africa. All right, we got five from our church who are going this year, joining about 65 others from all over the United States and one from Canada, I believe, and ready for our two-week medical mission trip in the Ivory Coast of Africa. I've had a few people ask me, Tim, are you flying through Ouagadougou, Burkina Faso this year? No, we're not, all right? So don't worry about that, all right? For us, we're not going there. Every year before we go, something bad happens somewhere near the Ivory Coast, and those kind of things doesn't stop God's work from being done, all right? And so we're going through Brussels, Belgium this time, all right? So that's a whole lot safer. Somebody asked me, are you scared? No, Brussels Airport will be one of the safest airports in the world right now, all right? And I'm not leaving the airport, all right? So all is good. We're excited about our trip and just be praying for us as we leave. The great news is I will be back for Valentine's Day with my wife this year, all right? So that'll be pretty awesome. So do be praying for that trip. Let's see, please note that Grief Share is going to be starting up, and there are contact numbers for Sue Krausen here. It's going to start in February. If you've experienced a loss and a death in your life over these last 6 months or a year, why don't you join with Sue and some others who are going through the very same thing. Hundreds in our church and our community have been helped, and they would love to be of help and encouragement to you at this season in your life. So please follow up with that. Ladies, please notice that there is a spring luncheon coming up, and tickets are going to go on sale before very long. I'm sure that you're going to hear from Fawn in a week or two about that big event, but get it on your calendar and anticipate what's going to be happening there. Not going to say much about Sunday school teachers. I think I said it all pretty directly last week. We had three people, I think, who've talked to Jennifer about signing up and being Sunday school teachers. We could use three or four more. I hope that's something you have been in prayer about for this past week. Our Mexico mission trip with our high school student ministries will be kicking off in just a week or two. And the kids are already preparing, but we'll launch it here with our church family in just a couple of weeks. So please be in prayer for that. We not only have a Tuesday night women's Bible study and a Wednesday morning women's Bible study, but there's going to be a brand new study made available to women who maybe can't do something during the week. It's on the subject of prayer. It comes out of the driving message of the war room. And to tell us a little bit more about that is Julie. Julie, where? Oh, there you moved on me. All right, come on over here. And use the voice you use to talk to your husband. Okay, you're first graders. Okay, all right.
Good morning, and this coming Saturday, the 23rd, we're going to start a new kind of small group ladies study on strategic prayer. It addresses the 10 areas of your life that the enemy likes to target and focus on, and we're going to explore how to strategically pray over those areas of our life. We would be thrilled to have you join us. It's from 9 to 10 on Saturdays for the next 11 weeks. We'd love for you to come and be part of it and make a battle plan for your life. So,
great. Julie, thank you. We're excited about that. So, ladies, that's what the sign-up sheet is for. So I have one in here right now instead of two. So it's going to go around. They would like your contact information, either your email preferably, if you do not have an email, your phone number. They want to make sure they have enough materials for Saturday. Since I only have one clipboard, when it gets to that last row back there, pass it across, all right? And then it should make its way up and end up right here, all right? There's another event that I just want to clarify on February the 21st. Let me actually read to you what that event is all about. It's not just for men, okay? This is something I briefly talked about last week. This is for all adults in our church who find themselves in the age group of 25 to 40. And so here's the deal. If you are a wife, all right, and you happen to be under 40, and you're married to a guy who happens to be over 40, we grandfather him in, all right? So you can bring him with you. If you are in your mid-20s and you're a guy and you're 26 and you're married to a delightful young lady who's 24, she's grandfathered in. Do you get the picture? All right? So, but we're wanting this age group to come. And here's why, and personal invitations will be distributed over the next couple of weeks for this event on February the 21st. I just want you to get it on your calendar, all right? 5 o'clock, it's not going to be a long meeting, probably an hour, and then some refreshments afterwards. But New Hope has a big desire to be a church that connects to every generation. And on Sunday, February the 21st at 5 p.m., we want to meet with all adults, 25 to 40, married, single, engaged, parent, single parent. We want to hear from you, and we want to share our hearts with you. Our desire is for New Hope to be a place that is healthy for you and desirable for your friends. Please come and help us make that possible. Tim and Mark, that is Pastor Mark Addis, we believe this to be a make-a-difference moment in New Hope's history. We hope to see you. And your presence will make a difference. And so we have more to share with you, but I think that's enough to get the invitation out. Get that on your calendar, and we hope to see you that evening. I think I have covered all of the events that are coming up. Please read the bulletin. There's other things on there, but we've already talked about most of them recently. I've got a lot of lists of things for us to pray about today. This has been... For me, this was a very blessed week. As most of you know, I got to leave on Tuesday, got to go spend about 64 hours with my grandson, Bo. Can't tell you how smart he is, but he's awfully cute, okay? He didn't say Grandpa Tim yet, so I can't attribute to his brilliance, but I can attribute to his cuteness. And he snuggles. He likes to snuggle. So that was great fun. But... In the course of this week, it has been a very challenging week for several families that I know about and maybe even for some that I don't know about. So let me start at the very beginning of the week. On Monday morning, got a call from Phil and Hazel Wright. Their seats are empty right there, all right, today. Phil Wright's son, who's in his mid-50s, he's been a doctor at Children's Hospital in a specialty of rheumatology. His name is Dwayne Wright. Big swimming family. Both of his kids were All-American swimmers in high school. One of them plays on a college water polo team. The other one swims for USC. Tied Michael Phelps' college record in one of the events. And dad was responsible for their love for swimming. He's been a swim club coach and participant for decades. And in the pool at Bullard High School with a swim team he's been a part of, he died of a heart attack on Monday morning. And so Phil and Hazel, as you can well imagine, have been devastated by that this week. The services are going to be tomorrow. Phil and Hazel's son and daughter-in-law attended regularly at Trinity Church, and the service is going to be at Clovis Hills because of the size of the attendance. And then the reception is going to be at Holy Spirit Church. I want to say thank you to so many of you who responded so very quickly to an email I sent in the middle of the week requesting desserts. We made the offer, anything that we can do just to show Phil and Hazel that we love them, and they were in need of desserts, and so you all responded before the afternoon was over. We had more desserts than we asked for, so thank you very much for helping. It means so much to Phil and Hazel to know that others are coming around them to help. So please continue to pray for them. And that service is tomorrow at 11 o'clock. Midweek, after I'd just been in Tennessee, I got a text from my sister telling me she had just talked to our aunt in Oklahoma And my cousin Phil, who lives in Oklahoma City, his 42-year-old daughter died unexpectedly of a heart attack in her car. And that service is going to be Tuesday in Oklahoma. Then on Friday morning, I got a text from Mike Adams. Mike Adams was part of our church for many, many years. He now lives in Sacramento. I am indebted to Mike. I will be indebted to Mike for the rest of my life. It is Michael Adams who brought Shelley to New Hope Church the very first time, right after she had moved to town. That was the only person she knew, and he invited her to come to church. And so I'm indebted to Mike Adams. On December the 30th, I stood with Mike in the ER room as they disconnected his dad from life support, and he passed away that evening. And I got a text on Friday morning that Thursday night late, his mom passed away. So just 3 weeks apart between his mom and his dad. So if you would be praying for Mike Adams, I know he would appreciate that so much. And then I just received a message just a few minutes ago. Pastor Radke. Pastor Radke was the founding pastor of the original New Hope. Okay, the New Hope that merged with Ashbrook Church. And Bob Radke has been here. We honored him at our 20th anniversary of the merger, and I understand that he died on Friday the 15th. And the services for him are going to be Saturday the 23rd at Bethany Church. And do we know what time that is going to be at? Okay, so we're unsure of that time, but we'll let him know in the office, and you can certainly call, or we'll send out an email with that time on it. And then, just happened between first and second service, Helen Heath, who usually sits right here, she fell while she was getting out of her truck, and she hit her head. She had a very low blood pressure. The ambulance came, and they have taken her to Kaiser today. And so we want to be praying for all of these this morning. So I also received information in the 8 o'clock service. I'm going to show that I'm a grandfather right now. I'm having a senior moment. Yeah, I like that. Pre-senior moment. That was brilliant. Fern's granddaughter, Fern Wood's granddaughter that has the tumor behind the eye, they leave tomorrow for Boston. And they will start their series of treatment and surgery that they hope will save her eye and deal with the cancer. They'll be gone for 7 weeks. They'll be living in a Hope home there in Boston. So if you would remember to pray for Fern's granddaughter, God knows her name, and it'll come back to me in a little bit. So anyway, those are, as you can tell, it has been a week filled with challenges. It's great to have Tim back with us today. We've missed him for the last couple of months. If he walks with a limp, it's because just a little over a week ago, we had knee surgery. And he's able to be with us today, and we're grateful for that. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our tithes and offering. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, the adventure of this week has done its best to discourage a lot of people. It's done its best to bring us into the valley of despair. And Father, it's not a coincidence that that we have a Bible study starting on Saturday that deals with the subject of prayer and how the enemy likes to attack us. It's no accident or coincidence that today's sermon is found out of Psalm chapter 5, which is a prayer in the life of David in the season of discouragement. And so, Father, I trust that for others besides those that we have mentioned who have come here today and life has done its best to beat them down, that by the time this day is over, by the time our hearts have worshiped in music, by the time our souls have meditated in prayer, and by the time that our mind has been challenged with your word, we will walk away from here with valuable lessons from the life of David that will teach us how to face these kind of moments in life, not only for now, but also for our future. We thank you for the blessings, and we trust you for the challenges. For the opportunity of giving and sharing today, we say thank you. I trust we do so joyfully, knowing that whether it's out of our abundance or out of our poverty, we give because we trust you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Perfect music for where we're going in the scriptures today. Perfect music for what we launched last week. There were about 120 new Hopians last Sunday throughout the three services that committed to joining other members of God's family from other churches throughout the cities of Fresno and Clovis for 21 days of prayer and fasting. We passed out a paper last week. If you didn't get it, call the office this week. We'll be happy to send it to you. Talking about fasting, that always scares people. And last week we shared with you, this is not just about if you fasting from food, all right? That was what culturally in those days would free up time for them to spend more time in prayer. We got a lot of things today that occupy our time. And so it's asking us, it fits into what we launched the first Sunday of this year, the Less More Lifestyle. That is our year-long sermon series, Less of Me, More of Jesus. We just sang about it. Thank you, Tim. Thank you. It's perfect. That last song talked about us being on our knee, praying for revival. And the purpose of these 21 days is to pray for renewal in our churches and revival in our cities. And so let's just touch base quickly on this. I've heard from about a half a dozen of you this past week, just kind of giving me an update of how you were doing and what you'd given up. I've had two or three people tell me they've given up Facebook for 21 days, all right? They're not posting anything on Facebook, all right, at all for 21 days. That's big. Well, one of them told me they probably spent about 2 hours a day posting on Facebook. That's 2 hours praying now. I had a gentleman, sports fanatic, okay, a sports fanatic man send me an email this week that said, Tim, I've given up 21 days of television. This is playoff time, guys. This is playoff time. And this man giving up 20. I will say this. The Super Bowl comes on after his 21 days are up. I don't know that he figured that out, but the good news is he can watch the Super Bowl if he chooses to. But he gave up 21 days. I told you all last week, I wasn't really necessarily giving up something. I was choosing something. I was choosing to journal. I've done it for a week. I still hate it, okay? I don't like it. I'm not going to have to burn mine because I'm doing it on my iPhone, and so at the end of 21 days, I can delete mine, okay? And here's what I can tell you happened to me this week in journaling. Number one, there was a day or two I just sat blank for a little while, just absolutely blank. But once the thought started, it began to flow. There were three nights I kind of forgot to do it. So God woke me up, and I couldn't go back to sleep. I said, oh, I didn't do my journal. I journaled. I eventually went back to sleep. So this is kind of a partnership between you and God. All right, of what we're choosing to do, to set aside, to focus our attention. This is what, for these days, not to twist God's arm, it's more about us giving more of ourselves to Him and having less of Him functional in us. And that's the purpose for this. So, just to touch base, those of you who raised your hand last week, how many of you kind of you've done 7 days now, you're 1 week down, one third of the way, in case you hadn't figured it out, 21 days is 3 weeks. Okay, so we're 1 week down. How many of you who raised your hands? You did it every day this past week. You did whatever it was. Good, good. That's not as many hands as went up last Sunday. Okay, here's the, how many of you did it most of the days this week, but maybe you slipped up once or twice, but you did it most of the days this week. Raise your hand. It's okay. The others, raise your hand too. You did it all 7 days. Now others, you can raise your hand. Here's the deal. If you missed a day, don't quit. Just start back up. All right, just start back up. We still got 14 days to go. All right, good. Keep it up. Keep it up. One last announcement, and that is if you haven't been here yet this year, what I would encourage you to do is go back to the Sunday 2 weeks ago, and it is posted on the website, and listen to the first sermon that launched this series. It's foundational for what we're doing. If you don't do it, it doesn't mean you shouldn't come back for the whole rest of the year because you'll miss out. No, each Sunday will stand kind of on its own, but in the context of what we're doing for the entire year, less, more lifestyle. And if you recall, we're doing the less, more lifestyle. It requires four things, okay? First thing was a choice. We must make a choice. Just as John the Baptist said, I must decrease, so he must increase. We must make that choice, as Joshua did in the Old Testament. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. It's a choice. That choice can only be maintained by, what was the second key point? Consistency. That's not only a once-in-a-lifetime choice, it's once I've made the choice, I must continue to make the choice. Consistency is required. And then the third thing to maintain this less more lifestyle is accountability. Choice, consistency. What helps us with consistency is tell somebody. Be accountable. Tell your spouse, tell your small group, or tell somebody and be held accountable and say, hey, I'm giving you permission. When you see this area of my life, call me up short. And number four, the one that really excited everybody, contemplation. And 98% of us have no idea how to do that. Okay? And that's why we've chosen the Psalms for our direction of study for this entire year. There's 150 chapters in the Psalms, so there's no way that we're going to preach all 150 chapters this year. But we're going to hit about 50 of them, all right? So about one-third of them. We're going to do Psalm kind of like the same way you eat an elephant. One bite at a time. We're going to do this one chapter at a time over the course of this year. And it's through the Psalm over time that we will learn how to do that final step in the process. Once we've made the choice and we're consistently making the choice and we're being held accountable to the choice, we will grow as a result of that choice through contemplation. And it is the book of Psalm that will help us do that. I invite you, if you would please, to turn to Psalm chapter 5. And that is where our study will begin today. The book of Psalm, found right in the middle of your Bible. As you know, the middle chapter of the entire Bible is found there. Psalm 118, and the middle verse of the Bible is 118:8 that says, do not put your trust in man, but put your trust in God. You can center your life on the center verse of the Bible, and everything else will work from there. So, Psalm chapter 5. We got a brand new heating unit on this side of the building. It had gone out 2 weeks ago. It's working, isn't it? I've now turned the air conditioner on, all right, to 70 degrees. It hasn't kicked in enough yet. So with your permission, actually without your permission, I am taking my jacket off. Okay, yeah, after service. Let's read Psalm 5. Give ear to my words, O Lord, and consider my sighing. Listen to my cry for help, the one who is my king and my God. For it is to you alone I pray. Morning by morning, O Lord, you hear my voice. Morning by morning, I lay my request before you, and I wait in expectation. You are not a God who takes pleasure in evil. I think David could have said easily here, and I don't think I'm doing injustice to the passage, you are not a God who takes pleasure in my evil or the evil of others. With you, the wicked cannot dwell. The arrogant, verse 5, the arrogant cannot stand in your presence, and you hate all who do wrong. You destroy those who tell lies. Ouch. Bloodthirsty and deceitful men, the Lord abhors. But I, by your great mercy, that means I don't deserve this privilege I'm about to share in. I didn't earn it. I'm able to do it because of your mercy towards me. And what is that? I will come into your house. You have to understand something, folks. No temple's been built yet in Jerusalem. No temple's been built. What David wants us to understand is he's coming into the intimate fellowship with God. It's where God meets him morning by morning. I come into your presence. In reverence will I bow down toward your holy temple. Lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of mine enemies. Make straight your way before me. Not a word from their mouth can be trusted. That's the mouth of his enemies. Their heart is filled with destruction. Their throat is an open grave, and with their tongue they speak deceit. For some reason, God, these folks are mad at me, and when they talk about me, they do so harshly. Declare them guilty, O God. Let their intrigues be their downfall. Banish them for their many sins, for they have rebelled against you. But let all who take refuge in you be glad. Let them ever sing. There we go, Tim. Let them ever sing for joy. Spread your protection over them, that those who love your name may rejoice in you. For surely, O Lord, you bless the righteous. You surround them with your favor as with a shield. One Sunday in a Midwest city, there was a little boy who was acting up during the morning worship service. His parents were doing their very best to maintain some sense of order in the pew, but they were losing the battle. Finally, the father picked up his little son and walked sternly up the aisle, and on his way out, just before reaching the safety of the foyer, the little boy called loudly back to the congregation, "Pray for me! Pray for me!" The little boy believed in prayer, didn't he? The question, though, for us this morning is, do we believe in prayer as the little boy did, or do we believe in prayer the way David did? And there's a difference. You see, the little boy just believed in emergency prayers. David believed in morning by morning prayers. Psalm 5 has been called a morning psalm because of the words in verse 3. David, throughout his life, was a warrior. He fought a lot of battles in his lifetime. As a boy, those battles were engaged against bears and lions, according to 1 Samuel 17, as he was a shepherd. As a grown man, his battles were against the enemy of his people, Israel. As a warrior, David had a lot of enemies. Those enemies were in the armies of foreign countries. And the reason that they didn't like David is because he was a winner. And they didn't like him because he won, because of his success. But David also had enemies from inside his own people. Even Saul, who David was committed to and loyal to, Saul grew with resentment and bitterness and anger and tried to destroy David. The people would join the city streets when Saul and David would come back from battle, and they would begin to sing the song, "Saul has slain his thousands." That ought to make Saul feel good. And it did till the next line. "But David, his tens of thousands." And the reason David did what he did was because of his love and loyalty to Saul. But Saul was blinded by the love of the people for David, that he missed the love of the people for him. David even had enemies inside his own family. And it is in this psalm that David has obviously come to the end of his rope with the verbal attacks from enemies. Specifically, people who have been spreading malicious untruths about him. Are you familiar with the old children's saying? I'm sure you are. "Sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me." That song's not true. Obviously, it's not true. Just the fact that children would use this to respond to those who were saying hurtful things shows that words can hurt. And it's not just for kids. Let me do a very quick, very informal survey. And this will be self-inclusive. How many of us in this room have been hurt by someone who either exaggerated, lied about us, or said mean things about us? Probably no one in the room is exempt. The other part of the survey I'm leaving out today is how many of us have ever said hurtful or untruthful things about somebody else. Perhaps all of us can identify with David this morning. As we study this psalm, we'll not only identify with David's feelings when people verbally attack us, but we'll also see how to respond to the problem. Some psalms can be difficult to outline, and others lend themselves to very organized thoughts. And Psalm 5 finds itself in this latter category. It's easy to lay out an outline. It begins with a plea and it ends with a promise. And sandwiched in between the plea and the promise are four descriptions. So an outline, if you take notes and like this kind of stuff, here's the way the outline would look. Point number one, a plea, found in verses 1-3. Point number two, four descriptions described for us in verses 4-11. A description about what the Lord is like, a description about what the psalmist is like, a description about the enemies, and a description about the righteous. And then this is wrapped up in verse 12 with a promise. So let's jump in. Let's make three observations about the plea. First of all, we notice, according to verse 3, that this was a morning prayer. David mentions it twice, that in the morning he met with the Lord. Even though he thought it might be a bad day, he met with the Lord. Even though it was going to be a bad day, he was going to start it right. Do you know sometimes in advance you've got a bad day ahead of you? We do. Sometimes we get caught by surprise, like the rites this past Monday. But sometimes we know we're going to have a bad day, and we've got one of two choices then, folks. We can start the day right, or we can start the day poorly. If you've been around New Hope long, you've probably heard this story before. I was about 21 years of age when John Hunter was speaking at Reedley Mennonite Brethren Church. John Hunter was a member of the preaching team for the Torchbearers International. He traveled the world speaking, tall, thin Englishman, very proper. But oh, could he preach? Oh, could he help you understand the truth of the Scripture? John Hunter said, here's the way I start my day. As soon as I open my eyes, I try to remember to make my bed a cross. And he said, I lay on my back and I stretch out my arms. And with his dry British humor, he said, and I look over to see if I need to apologize to my wife. Boom! And he said, I start my day, oh Lord, today I want to be crucified with your Son, the Lord Jesus. This is the day that you have made. I want to be glad and rejoice in it. And the only way I can do that is to be dead to self and alive to Christ. So before my feet ever hit the ground this day, oh Lord, I die to myself so I can live by you. Amen. And I said, I go through the adventure of my day and I try to stay connected to how I started my morning. And he said, then when I come back to bed tonight, and he said, and I take my clothes off and set my shoes on the side of my bed, and I sit on my bed and I lay down, he said, I extend my arms again, and I look over to see if I need to apologize to my wife. And he said, then I end my day, Lord Jesus, I know there have been a few times today that I've crawled off this cross and I've done it my way. I'm so sorry. Thank you for your forgiveness. But I want to end this day in deep gratitude to you for your full availability to me. And tomorrow may I learn more how to stay on the cross. In Jesus' name, amen. Not a bad way to begin and end a day. It's what David tells us here, morning by morning. The second thing we notice about this plea is this prayer was delivered by somebody who was becoming increasingly discouraged. Notice the first two verses and how this plea grows in its intensity. He first of all says, give ear to my words. Would you pay attention? And then he says, consider my groaning, my sighing. And then he says, heed my cry. Would you just listen to me? Husbands, have you ever had your wives do that to you? They take both of your cheeks and each of their hands, and they get like this and they say, could you listen to me? And this is what David is doing with God. God, I want to make sure. What's on my heart is important. Have you ever prayed under the cloud of growing discouragement? If you have, please take heart. You are in good company. David is one of those. He wrote this psalm just for us, for just that moment. But David's not the only guy in company with us. Several years ago, a young Midwestern attorney suffered from deep depression. Depression that was so deep, his friends thought it best to keep the knives and the razors out of his reach. He questioned his life's calling and the prudence of even attempting to follow through on it. During one of those times, he journaled. And if he would have burned that journal, I could not read this to you today. But he wrote these words, "I am now the most miserable man living. Whether I shall ever be better, I cannot say. I awfully forebode that I shall not." But somehow, from somewhere, and I can tell you where, because of another one of his journal entries, this attorney found his refuge and his comfort in the Psalms. And Abraham Lincoln received the encouragement he needed, and the rest of his achievements throughout his life vindicated the source of his strength and his discouragement. Third, the psalmist anticipated God's intervention. By faith, David counted on and trusted in the Lord's availability to him. There are two statements in verse 3 that reveal this. "I will order my prayer to you, and I will eagerly watch." The Hebrew word that can be translated order literally means to make an order. And that statement could be read this way: "In the morning, I will place my order with you." Some of you might find that a little presumptuous. You might even think it's a little bit bossy. But you have to understand, I think this is said in the spirit of somebody who is holding a menu. And he's read the menu. He knows what the one who printed the menu will provide for him. And so in the morning he says, "God, off your menu, this is what I want." He places his order from the Lord's menu of blessing. And it's an extensive menu. He then says, "I will eagerly watch." Literally, "I will look forward to." "I will anticipate." After placing his order, he anticipates an answer from the Lord. If you've ever had the opportunity to eat at Fleming's restaurant and you place an order for a filet mignon, you will eagerly anticipate its arrival. Apart from the day that I married Shelley, I probably not have as anticipated anything more eagerly than I did when I got off the plane in Knoxville on Tuesday evening at 4:05. And the 30-minute drive from Chad picking me up at the airport back to the house where baby Bo was to be found, that 30 minutes seemed a lot longer than the 4.5-hour plane ride from Fresno to Knoxville. Why? Because I was eagerly anticipating, holding in my arms what I'd only seen in a picture. And David says, "I eagerly watch with anticipation." David refused to stumble about stoop-shouldered, carrying his burdens throughout the day. On the contrary, he took his needs to the Lord each and every morning. When you and I think of placing an order, remember something essential. Be specific. Too many prayers are prayed from timidity and vagueness. Some of you are saying, "Tim, I've heard you say, hey, when you pray, don't give God orders." I still mean that. David didn't say, "Give God orders." David said, "Place your order." Place your order from the menu. Not from my wants, not from my desires. Place my order from his menu. That is the reason, folks, you need to be in this book more than on Sunday mornings. You need to know this menu so that when an occasion arises, you can order from the menu what God's promises and God's wills are, not what you want. And there's sometimes a big difference. You see, you need to know that on the menu is peace that passes human understanding. So as you face circumstances that you cannot control the outcomes in, okay, God, I'll rest in your peace. You need to understand he offers to us contentment. And Paul wrote that from a prison cell, incarcerated, for something he didn't do. Well, yeah, he did do it right. He did something right that was wrong. He preached Jesus when they told him, "Stop preaching Jesus." And so he ended up in prison, but he said, "Hey, here in this cell, I'm content. With my back bloodied and beaten, I'm content." That's something you can order from the menu at the beginning of a day that you know is going to be filled with trouble and discouragement. On the menu is joy unspeakable, full of glory. On the menu is God's presence wherever you are. on the menu is unconditional love from God, despite what others have said about you or what you have said about yourself. Know the menu and then boldly tell God what you need. When we ask for what He has promised or anticipated to be His will, we can with great eagerness expect it to be met. After David placed a specific order every morning, he anticipated the answers. He looked forward throughout the day. When our outlook is dim in the morning, when discouragement worms its way into our life, a good remedy is to focus our attention upward. What a difference that makes in our day. Throughout Scripture, spiritual turning points occur at morning time. Darkness gives way to the light. Contemplation yields insight. And just as a way of a personal testimony, if you were here on the Sunday right after I recovered from the stents, and I confess to you, there were a couple of mornings, a couple of nights I was scared. A couple of nights I couldn't sleep, I couldn't find rest. A couple of nights that without God working through Shelley would have been the most miserable nights of my life. She sang and she prayed and she played YouTube hymns for me. And guess what? She got me through the darkness of the night and in the rising of a sun. Just light shining in a window in a bedroom. Life was better. Another day. And that's God in us. Listen, that's not just a personal example. Listen to a few out of the Scriptures. Psalm 30, verse 5. For His anger lasts only a moment, but His favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. Listen to Psalm 88, 13. But I cry to You for help. In the morning, my prayers come before You. Lamentations 3, 22 and 23. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness. Haven't we sung that for decades? That's where it comes from. And then out of the testimony of the life of Christ Himself, Mark 1:35, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up and left the house, and He went off to a solitary place where He prayed. High school students, it's tough to get up early. Any of you have a zero period? Oh, God bless you. Wise decision. Your parents thank you also for not taking a zero period. Brant did that once. I could have hung him. All right, it was horrible. No buses run. He wasn't old enough to drive yet. Guess who had to take him? Yeah. Before you start a day at school, get up a little early and start your morning. Some of you seniors who've learned how to sleep in, don't sleep in so far. Get up. Start your day with Him. Those of you who go to work every day, you punch the clock. If you take time to eat breakfast, pray. You take time to get dressed, I hope. Okay. Pray. That ought to be as vital part of your day as brushing your teeth and eating your breakfast and putting your clothes on. Pray. David cries become more desperate as he continued to suffer and continued to seek God's intervention. And then he prayed with confidence in the Lord's sovereignty and God's goodness. In fact, he decided to begin every morning this way. He began by placing his order and resolving to wait with confidence for God's response. So how do we apply this? What has you most discouraged right now? And in those 5 seconds, you know what it is. You know exactly what has you most discouraged right now. Loss of a job, loss of a relationship, loss of your health, loss of a family member. What has you most frustrated right now? Has this discouragement affected your prayer life? Perhaps like David, you might pray with confident expectation and complete trust in God's sovereignty and goodness. This is hard to do at first, but eventually your attitude will become like your prayers. But if you don't pray, your prayers will be like your attitude. Choice is yours. 4 descriptions. Oh, I gotta go fast. After the plea in verses 1 through 3, David begins to think through the day. He spreads out before him, giving extra consideration to those that he would encounter, his friends, his appointments, the strangers, and even his enemies. And he addresses four realms of interest. David meditates in verses 4 through 6 on God. In verses 7 through 8, he describes himself. In verses 9 through 10, he describes his enemies. And in verse 11, he describes the righteous. Just highlight a little bit of this with me. He starts with God. He mentions seven specific things about the Lord. He says God takes no pleasure in wickedness. There is no evil that dwells in Him. I want to pause right there. When you read the Old Testament, sometimes you think, ooh, God was an evil guy. No, He wasn't. You just don't understand the nature of God from God's perspective. You'll find out why in a few minutes. It wasn't that God was evil, it was that God dealt with evil. That's what brings us to the next one. Arrogant boasters will not stand before Him. Brings us to the next one. He hates workers of iniquity. Next one, He destroys those who lie. He abhors murderers. He abhors deceivers. Why does David feel a need to review this? Because it's therapeutic to review the attributes of God. Just like there is great benefit in telling your spouse how much and why you love them again and again. God is always good and right in His ways. His love for us never wavers, and His timing is always perfect. Many of the pent-up anger and frustration of our inner emotional tank are diffused as we remember God's character and we remind ourselves that He is for us and He is not against us. Focusing on His character helps dispel discouragement. Furthermore, we are reminded that our enemies are really God's enemies. He is more powerful than any evil and more persistent than any challenging circumstance. As for those who try to harm us, whether it's physically, emotionally, or verbally, the Lord is far more capable of dealing with them than we are. So how do I apply this? In the midst of discouragement, it's easier to number our frustrations than it is to count our blessings. So instead, let's create a list of God's attributes from Scriptures. It's another reason you need to be in this book. Tell me, what is God like? Write those things down from Scripture. This psalm is a great place to start, but it's not the only place. And then pray through the list of God's characteristics. Praise Him for each attribute. Thank Him for who He is. How about an experiment for the rest of this 21 day of prayer and fasting? And if you didn't join in, how about just trying this for a week? How about praying through the list of God's attributes, thanking Him for them, and don't ask Him for a thing. And journal your week. Having reviewed God's character, sovereign and good, David now focuses on himself. He begins with a strong contrast. The Hebrew is exceptionally strong. He says, "But me, as for me," in contrast to those whom the Lord would destroy, David enjoyed a spiritual position, a personal relationship, which he talks about in verse 7. "I'm in your holy temple." Verse 8 is the major prayer of the song. Everything before this verse could be considered preliminary. This is the nugget of his request. He says, "Lead me in your righteousness because of my foes. Make your path straight before me." Here's what David is really saying. David said, "God, I don't want to resort to acting like my enemies." In David, there is no "I'll do like you've done to me" tactic. He prayed for the Lord to lead him throughout the conflict, prompting him to do things God's way, like George Whitefield did. George Whitefield was an evangelist from England. He lived in 1714 to 1770, and he learned that it was more important to please God than to please men. Knowing that he was doing what was honoring to the Lord kept him from discouragement when he was falsely accused by his enemies. At one point in his ministry, Whitefield received a vicious letter. Remember, this guy who sent him a letter was another pastor. Sometimes our enemies are inside the family. Whitefield received this letter accusing him of wrongdoing. His reply was brief and courteous. He wrote back to the gentleman, "I thank you heartily for your letter. As for what you and my other enemies are saying against me, I know worse things about myself than you could ever say. With love in Christ, George Whitefield." He didn't try to defend himself. He was much more concerned about pleasing God. And David wanted to follow in God's righteous ways, first and foremost. Not too many years later, Isaiah the prophet spoke to Israel on God's behalf. And God said this, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heaven is higher than the earth, so are my way higher than yours, and my thoughts greater than yours." When discouraged, we naturally pray for relief. The little boy going into the foyer, "Pray for me!" We beg God to act on our behalf. What if we ask for the opportunity in our discouragement to do something for God? How might our perspective change if we begin to see ourselves as agents of God's will right where we are, acting on His behalf, carrying out His desires, rather than always expecting Him to serve us? When is the last time you asked God for the opportunity to do something for Him? Maybe today would be a good time, especially if you're struggling with discouragement. When we pray for His strength to carry out His will, it's likely our sense of powerlessness will quickly fade. And let's wrap this up with the promise. God's shield against discouragement. Sometimes we experience discouragement because of nothing particularly wrong that we did. Natural disaster, disease, economic downturn, injury. Sometimes we suffer because people talk badly about us. And that's David's lament in this passage. He knew discouragement can easily escalate to resentment, bitterness, hatred, and ultimately retaliation. David feared becoming like his oppressors. So he reflected on the Lord's character rather than on the actions of his enemies. You see, David did not want to allow discouragement to become resentment. He did not want resentment to become bitterness, and he did not want to stew in his bitterness till it became hatred, and finally, he would lash out against his enemies like they had lashed out against him. In his mind, David deliberately hands his enemies over to God. God has the sole authority to dispense justice or mercy. He also asked God to allow him to let them fall by their own devices. In other words, he said, God, I'm not asking you to heap coals of fire on them. Just let them come to their own just end. When dealing with those who oppose righteousness, it's helpful to remember that they are fighting against God, not us. Consequently, we can be sure He will not allow evil deeds to continue forever. He will limit sin and hold sinners accountable. If left alone in their own counsel, they'll fall all by themselves. Paul the Apostle said in Romans 12, never pay back evil for evil to anyone. Respect what is right in the sight of all. If possible, as it depends upon you, be at peace with all others. Never take revenge on your own, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And folks, there is a period there. There's not a comma for you to fill in the rest of the blank that says, God, can I be there when you do it? The daily grind of discouragement is lessened when we trust that God will fight our battles for us. So finally, having celebrated the righteous character of God, having requested strength to remain in God's righteousness, having considered the ultimate fate of evildoers, David imagined the future joy of the righteous. Verse 11, let all who take refuge in you be glad. Let them forever sing of joy. And may you shelter them, that those who love your name may exalt or be thrilled in you. The key thought here is joy. How are you doing with your countenance? Hurry up and look at the person right next to you. If you had to tell them what their countenance looked like, I wonder what you might say. Do you live above your pressures? Is there evidence of peace and joy written on your face? If we fight our own battles without the Lord, we become bitter, severe, cranky, and ultimately our face will be battle-scarred by resentment. I don't care how many tucks and lifts you get, you cannot hide resentment. I don't have time to tell you about Cain and Abel much today, but you know the two brothers both brought sacrifices. Abel brought the one that God requested. Cain brought a gift of his own choosing. It wasn't the desire of God's heart, it was the desire of Cain's heart. And God didn't accept it. Side note, a lot of people want to bring God gifts, but it's not the gift that He asks. We can do that with time. We can do that with money. We can do that with ministry. But God only takes delight in the gifts that He asks, not in the gifts of our own choosing. And the scripture says about Cain in verse 5 of chapter 4 of the book of Genesis, so Cain became very angry and his countenance fell. Fallen faces reveal discouraged hearts. David wanted God to take his inner burden and replace it with inner joy. And he said, when you do this, I'll surround you with favor as a shield. David closes the song with his eyes turned upward and away from the source of his discouragement. This is upper story living, not lower story focus. Having given God his burden in the morning, David's discouragement fled. And the shield that he mentions in verse 12 is the multiple shields were available to a warrior, but there was one that would cover from his head to his toe. That's the shield he mentions here. And do you know who or what that shield is in your life and mine? Right on the money. It's the Holy Spirit who lives in us. And when we start our day surrendered to Him, crucified, identified in the death of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit can cover us from head to toe. That's good stuff. I'll wrap it up with a story. A young woman named Margaret had spent decades battling depression and anxiety. In counseling, they were able to identify the source of these problems. It took her all the way back to the fifth grade, a classroom, where her teacher in school, who was frustrated with her Margaret's tardiness, made her stand in front of the room and invited all the students to come to the chalkboard and write something bad about Margaret. Those kids were ruthless, and that teacher was foolish. And those kids wrote things on a chalkboard: Margaret is ugly, Margaret smells, Margaret is stupid. Words do hurt, don't they? All 25 students went to the board and wrote hurtful things. This event inflicted wounds that Margaret could not find healing for. She battled depression and discouragement. She was angry most of her life. Finally, when she went to the psychologist for help, they spent 2 years meeting weekly. Finally, they had reached the conclusion of their sessions, and the counselor said, Margaret, I know this will be difficult, but to make sure you're ready to move on with the rest of your life, I'm going to ask you to do one thing one more time. I want to take you back to the schoolroom. I want us to sit in that room. I want you to detail the events of the day. I want you to take your time. And I want you to go to the chalkboard, and I want you to describe each of the children as they approach the blackboard. I want you to remember what they wrote and how you felt. And I want you to do this for all 25 students. In a way, this would be easy for Margaret, because for 40 years she had remembered every detail and every face. And yet to go through this nightmare one more time would take every bit of strength she thought she had. After a long silence, she began the painful description. One by one, she described each student vividly, as though she had just seen it happen minutes ago. Stopping periodically to regain her composure, forced herself to face each of the students one more time. Finally, she was finished. The tears would not stop. They could not stop. Margaret cried a long time before she realized somebody was whispering her name. Margaret! 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 She looked up to see her counselor staring her right in the face, saying her name over and over. Margaret, Margaret. Margaret stopped crying for just a moment. Margaret, you've left one person out. I did not. I've lived this story for 40 years. I know every student by heart. No, Margaret, you forgot someone. He's sitting in the back of the room. He's standing up now. He's walking towards your teacher. She's handing him a piece of chalk, and he's taking it. Margaret, he's taking it. Now he's walking over to the blackboard, and he picks up an eraser. He's erasing every one of those ugly comments about you. And now he's taking the chalk, and Margaret, he's writing, Margaret is loved. Margaret is beautiful. Margaret is smart. Margaret is caring. I love Margaret. You missed him, Margaret. Jesus is in the room with you. And Jesus can take all of their ugliness, and he can restore to you your beauty. And Margaret began to weep. But quickly the weeping turned into a smile, and then a laugh, and then tears of joy. The shield of Margaret's life was unleashed, and the presence of the Holy Spirit who brought the person of Christ to her. You discouraged today? Pray. Pray the character of God. Surrender all of those things that have been ugly and hurtful towards you. Surrender them to God and see what not only He says about Himself, but what He says about you. Our Father, those who may have been ground down by the discouragement in life, may by your words from the psalm find hope. for those who have been beaten down by Satan, whispering untruths and evil things in their ear. May they hear you say, I have come into this world because I love you. I love you. I love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.